Situation. Russian and Austrian forces are assembled at Austerlitz. Mission. In 1805, attack and destroy the enemy. Execution. Combined arms force of infantry, artillery, and cavalry. Administration. The Grand Army of France. Command and control. Napoleon Bonaparte.
I'm Captain Dale Dye. Welcome to Conquerors. In 1805, Napoleon Bonaparte's tactics of speed and surprise enabled his Grand Army to march over 700 miles and crush the two largest armies in Europe. The primary weapon in his arsenal was this, the Gribeval 8-pounder. Now, this cannon outranged the Austrian and Russian 6-pounders and had significantly more hitting power. Most importantly, it was more maneuverable. But the primary weapon of the era was Napoleon's mind. His tactics and daring at the Battle of Austerlitz established his reputation as one of history's greatest commanders.
To December 1805, Napoleon Bonaparte, Emperor of France, sat on his horse overlooking a field shrouded in fog. His men were about to engage the Allied forces of Austria and Russia near the small town of Austerlitz. Nearly 200,000 soldiers would fight in the most remarkable battle in Napoleon's epic career. Here, he'd set a grand trap. Here, he'd win his greatest victory. As the sun broke through the fog, revealing the gleaming bayonets, Napoleon's hour of glory had arrived.
If someone were to ask me what one battle in history should I study to learn about military brilliance, about how to lead men, Austerlitz would be the battle I would choose. I mean, it's really impossible to understate how enormous Napoleon becomes in the minds of the generals that will follow him. He exerts a tremendous influence on the American Civil War. Every American general sees in himself that he wants to be the next Napoleon.
Napoleon Bonaparte's rise through the military ranks and his incredible victories had made him a legend like his heroes, Alexander and Caesar. By December 1799, his skills as a military tactician and rallier of men had allowed him to become the ruler of France. He'd conquered Egypt, most of Italy, implemented civil codes, and even a new tax system. Then, in 1800, France defeated the Austrian army in Italy and Germany, making Napoleon the most powerful and feared man in Europe.
Napoleon is the most controversial figure in Europe at this time. And the opinions about him vary widely. I mean, some of his most inveterate enemies can't help but admire him. Ideologically, Napoleon is seen as the son of the French Revolution. So in all the conservative quarters of Europe, he's loathed. Many people feel he's really the Antichrist.
On 2 December 1804, Napoleon Bonaparte crowned himself Emperor of the French. It sent shockwaves throughout Europe. The First Council of the Revolution was now creating his own monarchy. The true blue bloods of Europe couldn't have that. What would be next, the conquest of their kingdoms?
To many people, he was an amazing person. People flocked to Paris to try to catch a glimpse of this stunning young man who had risen from obscurity to become the leader of one of the great countries of Europe. What they learned by 1805, of course, was that not only was Napoleon this meteor streaking to the top of power in France, but he was a great commander that they could not ignore if they ever chose to take him on.
At the beginning of 1805, Napoleon was stationed with his army of 210,000 men at the port of Boulogne, waiting for conditions to be right to invade England. His hatred of the British, the only nation to hand him his worst defeats, became an obsession.
England was determined to get rid of Napoleon. There had been a number of assassination attempts and it was the British who were financing and organizing that. So Napoleon eventually realized he had to either have a peace treaty with England or he had to conquer England. Well, he tried a peace treaty. In 1802, there was the Peace of Amiens. Ultimately, it was England that refused to withdraw forces from Malta as per the treaty. And so Napoleon decided, well, then I must conquer England.
They had trained for a war that was coming, they thought, with England. Every day, there would be battalion drills. Every other day in the morning, there would be live firing exercises. Now, intense training with soldiers that were already veterans in the wars of the French Revolution, this made Napoleon's Grand Armée, as he dubbed it in late August 1805, the finest army he had ever commanded.
The primary weapon of the French infantry was the Model 1777 Courage en Neuf, better known as the Charleville. The weapon weighed about 10 pounds and was approximately 5 feet long. It fired a relatively light 0.7-inch ball. For each shot, powder and ball had to be rammed home, and the weapon fired from a flintlock mechanism. A well-trained and disciplined soldier could get off about 5 rounds per minute. But all that black powder left a lot of residue or fouling. So the weapon had to be swabbed out about every 50 shots or there was a danger it would blow up in your face. If there wasn't any water readily at hand, soldiers simply urinated into the bore and used the acid in the urine to clean it out. Now, in combat, something like that can bring on some serious performance pressure.
However, Napoleon Bonaparte and his great army never crossed the English Channel. On 25 August 1805, they turned their attentions to face England on a completely different battlefield. William Pitt, the Prime Minister of England, had just lost the American colonies in their revolution. Now, France was threatening England's status in Europe. Pitt decided to form a coalition with his allies to thwart Napoleon's ambitions.
There had been two previous coalitions, and this third coalition was going to be the biggest and best yet. Russia got involved because the Tsar, Alexander, believed that he was a messiah that was going to re-energize and restore Europe's old order after the French Revolution. Tsar Alexander was only 27 years old. He was susceptible to flattery and to toadies and sycophants who surrounded him. He believed that he was going to be a great general, but he had no background or had never studied warfare or the military like Napoleon had.
The final leader of the Third Coalition was Francis I, the Habsburg Emperor of Austria. As the most conservative ruler in Europe, Francis was the most endangered by the radical ideals of the French Revolution. He'd been badly beaten by the French in 1800, and now Francis saw his chance for revenge. William Pitt paid the Austrians and Russians in gold to crush the newly crowned French emperor on land, while 175 British warships would continue to hold off Napoleon by sea. Austria and Russia, with a combined force of over 200,000 men, would target two regions allied to the French, the Kingdom of Italy and Bavaria. Inevitably, with a plan of that magnitude, Napoleon's network of spies soon sent word back to their emperor. Napoleon was always a step ahead of everyone. This master tactician would use Europe as his chessboard to demolish his enemies. On 8 September 1805, General Karl Mack led 72,000 Austrian soldiers into Bavaria. At the same time, coalition forces captured Hanover and invaded Italy. The Third Coalition had made their move to attack the French from all angles. With twice as many men, horses, and cannons as Napoleon, they seemed unbeatable. Napoleon at once saw a flaw in the Allied plan. Their forces were widely dispersed across the continent. Communication and coordination between these multilingual armies would be almost impossible. By moving quickly from his coastal camp, he could strike at the Austrians before the Russian army could even arrive.
He turns his army around and marches it straight east. Unbelievably, in complete secrecy, He seals borders. He shuts down newspapers. He sends out bulletins about how wonderful things are on the coast. He leaves some soldiers there to give the impression that he's there. In 40 days, he manages to march all the way across to the front where the Austrians and the Russians are beginning to put their groups together. It's an amazing thing. No one had ever done anything like it.
This speed was achieved because Napoleon had reorganized his army. Instead of one massive force, he created seven corps. Each corps was a self-contained army in miniature, led by a marshal who was capable of making independent decisions. A corps would have its own staff, its own infantry, cavalry, artillery, supply lines, and even medical teams. This corps system would be the key in helping Napoleon defend his country and conquer new lands.
The idea was, though, that they would never be more than a 24-hour march from each other. So if one got in trouble, another one could quickly come in to save the day. That was a far better system for maneuver than the Russian and Austrian systems, which were an old system based on a very central command and requiring enormously difficult communication lines from time to time. But the main thing that the French had that the other folks didn't, of course, was Napoleon himself. The Duke of Wellington is believed to have said at one time that Napoleon's hat on a battlefield was worth 50,000 men.
In less than 6 weeks, the French Corps reached the Danube River, catching the Austrian army by surprise. General Mack decided to make a fight of it at the city of Ulm. Napoleon's actions against Mack would become legendary and begin a campaign that would reward him with his greatest military victory, the Battle of Austerlitz. August 1805. Napoleon had marched his great army in secret to defend France from their new enemy, the Third Coalition. His corps had moved day and night, suffering many hardships to intercept the Austrian army led by General Mack.
The main advantage that the Allies, the coalition against Napoleon, had was sheer numbers. They had huge numbers of soldiers, they had a bigger fleet, they had more money. Mack made the unfortunate decision to move forward into Bavaria for the reason that he believed that Bavaria was going to join Austria against Napoleon. That proved to be completely false.
During September 1805, General Karl Mack and his Austrian army had occupied the city of Ulm in Bavaria. Ulm was a solid defensive position for the Austrian army. Past generals had always attacked the city head-on. However, Napoleon was about to change the rule book. He would trap Mack.
Napoleon had some experience fighting against coalitions. In his very first campaign, he devised his strategy of divide and conquer. Separate the parties and defeat them in detail. The Third Coalition was going to be no exception. He knew that the Austrians would be vulnerable, that it would take the Russians time to get there. Napoleon saw an opportunity to fall upon their rear and flank and encircle and cut them off from the rest of Austria. It's the precedent of the modern blitzkrieg.
Through sheer cunning and deception, Bonaparte engaged the Austrians with corps to the east and then whipped another corps around Ulm to isolate General Mack. By 14 October, the Austrian army was encircled and trapped in Ulm. A rumor that Napoleon might withdraw was shattered by a bombardment of artillery shells at the city's walls. As a formally trained artillery officer, Napoleon tended to make cannon the backbone of his tactics. Now, French artillery was generally employed in massed batteries, which means they could be used to soften up an enemy formation prior to musket volleys or a bayonet charge or a cavalry charge. Intense gun crew training allowed Napoleon's batteries to maneuver at high speed, which means that they could be used to reinforce a weak point in a defensive line or to hammer a hole in an enemy formation. Now, French artillery was generally classified as 4-pounder, 6-pounder, 8-pounder, or 12-pounder, depending on the size of the projectile that it fired. Maximum effective ranges? Somewhere out between
600 and 800 meters. Now, let's see what all this French noise is about.
General Mack hoped that his soldiers could hold the French back until 40,000 Russians came marching to their rescue. Unbelievably, the Third Coalition had made a major scheduling error. At the turn of the 19th century, Russia was still using the Julian calendar system, in which dates were 12 days later than the European Gregorian calendar. In their haste and overconfidence, no one in the Allied command had bothered to remember this.
General Mack is convinced that the Russians will be coming to his aid just any old time now. And in fact, they were almost 200 miles away. Well, that's a disaster, as you can well imagine.
On 20 October 1805, General Mack finally surrendered the city of Ulm. 27,000 men and 67 cannons were now Napoleon's prisoners. Mack had lost half of his entire Austrian army.
One of the things that became a famous saying after this campaign against Ulm was the fact that the French soldier said their emperor defeated enemies with their legs instead of their arms. Just by marching, just by swinging wide around Mack, they were able to cause his defeat. And it certainly was unprecedented and something no one had seen in Europe up to that time. For this disaster at Ulm, Mack became known as the unfortunate General Mack. He was, in fact, court-martialed and sentenced to death for this disaster.
Now, nothing stood between Napoleon and Vienna. On 14 November 1805, Napoleon led his soldiers into the capital of the ancient Austrian Empire. Emperor Francis had fled, leaving his palaces and gardens to the enemy. Bonaparte triumphantly paraded through the streets. 2 months before, he'd been encamped at the English Channel. Now, the Viennese elders were giving him the keys to their city. However, his triumph was overshadowed by the news of a disaster. Napoleon's navy had been crushed at the Battle of Trafalgar.
No longer could he easily go to North Africa. No longer could he go to the Middle East. No longer could he go to his colonies in North America without encountering the British fleet. All ideas of invading England were off the table. And what that meant was he looked eastward in the same way that Hitler did.
Napoleon ordered his troops to push further into Europe, to where the coalition forces were encamped outside of the Moravian town of Austerlitz. It would be a dangerous move. After spending several weeks in camp, the Great Army was starting to wonder if maybe they'd marched into a trap. With winter fast approaching, the conquest of Austria might be Napoleon's undoing.
It had been terrible for more than a month. The army had suffered horribly from straggling. The men were hungry, and the numbers continued to shrink daily.
The French army was surrounded by a hostile population. Coalition forces were stationed to the north, and Austrian reinforcements were expected to march up from battlefields in Italy to the south.
Despite the terrific victory at Ulm, Napoleon was not in the best of situations. He needed a battle. He needed to defeat the Russians and what remained of the Austrians, and he needed a conclusion to this campaign.
And there's also the matter of his image. If he leaves now without another great victory, then people are going to say, well, okay, he surprised General Mack at Ulm. Mack was a fool to allow that to happen. But when he was faced with the main Austrian and Russian forces, he turned tail and ran. You know, some people might say that Napoleon was taking a big gamble by staying and fighting the Allied forces. I don't think so. Napoleon's best option was to stay and fight, to seek one victory that would force a lasting peace.
Napoleon continued to lead his men east, further into enemy territory. On 20 November at Rausnitz, two divisions of French cavalry were attacked by 6,000 Russian horsemen who were looking to surprise Napoleon's flanks.
These mounted Russian cuirassiers carried a vicious 32-inch straight thrusting saber known as a palash. It had a fuller that ran the entire length of the blade. That made it lighter and gave the blood somewhere to run. These Russian cavalry were also armed with a brace of flintlock pistols like this one, for when times got bad, and they did. The Russians initially slashed through the French line, capturing an eagle and a standard, which was immediately delivered to an ecstatic Tsar.
However, after the initial surge, the French stopped the advance of the Russian cavalry due to their superior swordsmanship. The French were heavily outnumbered, but their disciplined charges forced the Russians back to their camp. It was a minor but important victory for Napoleon.
One of the examples of how Tsar Alexander was really out of touch with reality was the Battle of Rausnitz. What they saw was a tremendous victory with a captured eagle, and they couldn't wait to fight Napoleon because they were convinced that they were going to inflict the same sort of defeat on him at Austerlitz, when the reality was they'd lost at Rausnitz.
On 22 November 1805, the Russian and Austrian armies finally united into a single fighting force of 90,000 soldiers. Now, they fell under the command of General Mikhail Kutuzov.
Kutuzov was a legendary character in the Russian army. He had survived two head wounds, one of which a German doctor, upon seeing the scars, pronounced him a dead man. He knew how to present himself in such a way that he was beloved by the common soldier. Yet at the same time, he led a totally decadent, aristocratic sort of lifestyle. He would travel on campaign with immense amounts of baggage, including an extensive amount of French champagne, and always traveled with several women of lesser virtue. The Tsar described him, quote, as a hatcher of intrigues and an immoral and thoroughly dangerous character.
Most experienced generals would have retreated from an Allied force 90,000 strong. However, Napoleon would never retreat. He decided to lure the Allies into battle on ground of his own choosing. Napoleon would use deception to cause their destruction. He looked at his men and thought, one more battle.
Napoleon had chased the Allies as far as he could without the danger of being surrounded and cut off from his supply lines. So he called a halt east of the Allied positions near a town called Brno and had his troops prepare for battle. The local inhabitants were afraid that everything they owned would be devastated in the clash of two massive armies. So they sent a contingent of women to seek an audience with Napoleon and beg for mercy. They brought gifts of milk and food, but Napoleon's only appetite was for battle.
On 24 November 1805, Tsar Alexander called a council of war with Emperor Francis and General Kutuzov. Three plans were suggested. The first was to maintain their position at Olmutz and await Austrian reinforcements coming from battles in Italy. The second was to retreat eastward, drawing the French after them. The final option was to attack a seemingly weak Napoleon. General Kutuzov declared that supplies were short, and if they stayed, they'd starve. If they retreated, they could find fresh supplies, but the advancing French would find the countryside stripped bare and be stuck in the deadly Eastern European winter. It was the best option, but Kutuzov was not in command.
The problem that Kutuzov has, of course, is that he answers to the Tsar of Russia, Alexander. Alexander sees himself as a great leader also. And not surprisingly, if Alexander and Kutuzov don't agree, guess who wins?
Tsar Alexander wanted an attack. He wanted glory. They outnumbered Napoleon. This was their chance for fame. The Allied plan would be to turn the French army right, drive them back to the Danube River. However, this disorganized coalition couldn't execute their strategy until 4 days after their meeting. This gave Napoleon time to gather reinforcements and implement his own master plan.
And he set about in a series of what we would now call psychological operations to entice the Allies into attacking him, which was precisely what Napoleon needed.
One of the things that you never do in military science is to give up a strong position voluntarily, and yet that's exactly what Napoleon was going to do. The area of Austerlitz is dominated by the heights called Pratzen, and he gave up that position to show that he was vulnerable.
The Allies took the bait and moved onto the Pratzen Heights at Napoleon's right flank. Secretly, Napoleon had two corps marching from Vienna. Bonaparte was determined to fight this battle on his terms. He'd calculated the distance and speed of his reinforcements to arrive exactly when he needed them.
Certainly, he knew the relative strengths of his army and those of the enemy. He took the time to reconnoiter the ground over which he would fight, and he went to lengths to try to find out the psychological makeup, if you will, of his adversaries.
The Russians at one point send an emissary to Napoleon, and this emissary is some young fellow who's full of himself, and he lectures Napoleon on the politics of Europe and on how terrible Napoleon is and the French Revolution and so forth. Napoleon is livid, but he keeps his cool. He sits there and he takes it. This guy goes back and reports Napoleon is toast. You know, this guy listened to me. He has no faith in his own army anymore. He's on the outs. We can crush Napoleon if only we take action.
The Battle of Austerlitz would not only be a clash of armies, it would be a clash of cultures.
These armies really did embody the societies from which they came. The Russian society was one of the cruelest and most autocratic societies on the planet. And the Russian army was composed of serfs who were virtually slaves. Well, the Russians were famous for their tremendous, stolid defense. Napoleon said of them, it wasn't enough to kill a Russian soldier. You had to also go up and knock him over.
The Austrian army was organized in a way where there was a great deal of dependence on communication between various units and a central commander, a commander who might be far to the rear or far to one flank or the other, and it was a very difficult kind of army to maneuver. And to beat Napoleon, you had to be able to maneuver and maneuver quickly.
One tactical advantage for the French army was that they could rely on skirmishers, individual soldiers who went ahead of the main line of battle and acted as snipers.
Well, if you have soldiers who are patriotic and can be trusted and are motivated, they'll go out and do the sort of duty quite well. They'll show initiative. But on the other hand, if you have an aristocratic army where the soldiers are often there against their will, well, the officers don't trust them to go out on their own and do any fighting. So the French army has a huge advantage.
So the French Revolutionary Army becomes a model for society of being meritocratic, inclusive, egalitarian. And that's why, at least in its initial phases, it was so shocking and devastating.
On a cold, misty night before the battle, Napoleon Bonaparte rode among his soldiers. It was the eve of the first anniversary of his coronation as Emperor of France.
One of the grenadiers of the line regiments takes up a torch, lights it to be his escort to show him the way. Well, that's taken up by another, which is taken up by another, which is taken up by other groups until there are thousands of these torches lit as the emperor makes his way along the lines to the cries of Vive l'Empereur. And until you get this incredible scene of the army being around this beloved general. What's the incredible thing about that story is how that is misinterpreted on the Allied side, is that even though they see all these torches, even though they hear all this noise, they misinterpret this to meaning that the French army is retreating.
Napoleon was genuinely moved by this surprise spectacle. He'd call it the greatest night of my life. Napoleon's trap to snare the enemy was set, and he was confident. But so were the Allies. Within 24 hours, the Battle of the Three Emperors would be over, and one empire would be crushed. On 2 December 1805, both armies woke to a great fog covering the battlefield. Napoleon had anticipated that fog might cover his troops, helping in his surprise tactics. So far, that gamble had paid off. The Battle of Austerlitz would stretch over an 8-mile radius through several villages, streams, churches, and an old pheasantry. Today, the walls of the pheasantry are said to mark the places where Napoleon emplaced his cannons aimed toward the Allies up on Pratzen Hill. Napoleon had a great eye for terrain, and he'd handpicked this location to launch his most daring battle plan. He'd not only try to control his own men's actions, but those of his opponents. Napoleon maneuvered his army into three areas. The north, at Santon Hill, was to be held at all costs by Marshal Lannes' 5th Corps and Marshal Bernadotte's 1st Corps. In the center, Marshal Soult hid his corps out of Allied sight, ready to retake the Pratzen Heights. The French Imperial Guard would be held in reserve, back there in the fog, as a surprise. To the south, General Legrand had just 12,000 soldiers between the villages of Telnitz and Sokolnitz. This weak right flank was intended to draw the Allies into Napoleon's trap. Confusion and disorganization continued to trouble the Allies. Thick fog that welcomed them in the morning added to the chaos as they tried to maneuver into position. From his command post on the Pratzen Heights, Tsar Alexander, eager for victory, ordered the Allies down off the high ground toward Napoleon's weak right flank. They'd taken the bait. At 0600, an Austrian guard of 5,000 men attacked the village of Telnitz. As they marched through the mist, the French opened fire with their Charleville muskets.
They had some strong buildings, like a church, so they were able to implement their strong point defense scheme by putting the better units, the companies of grenadiers, in the church. They covered the village approachways with skirmishers. They then allowed the enemy forces to enter the village and then be counterattacked and trapped in the town, and they inflicted horrible damage on them.
After an hour, the French had forced the Austrians out. Even though the French were heavily outnumbered, they held their ground, picking off Austrians with great accuracy. Then, 14 squadrons of Allied cavalry rode through the village. The French retreated, and word was sent back to the two emperors. The Allied plan had worked.
Those people who were unable to escape just before the battle in these villages like Telnitz and Sokolnitz are suddenly in the middle of a battle where they could be killed by cannonballs, by fire. Men are charging into their homes during the battle, and afterwards their homes are filled by dead and wounded. It was a miserable, horrible situation.
But confusion was rampant in the Allied ranks. Maps were still being drawn up and instructions had to be translated. Austrian divisions then slowly arrived at the town of Sokolnitz. The giant granary building became the center of the fight and was fiercely contested. At this point, it seemed that the Allies still had the upper hand. From his command post on Zuron Hill, Napoleon carefully watched the Allied movement and timing. Napoleon would have a surprise waiting for them.
Napoleon's right flank was secured thanks to the heroic forced march of members of Marshal Davout's 3rd Corps, who executed one of the most staggeringly arduous forced marches in military history, 70 miles in less than 48 hours. They arrived on the battlefield absolutely exhausted. Over half the men were not present, but still trying to get there.
So far, Napoleon's enemy was behaving like they were conducting maneuvers on his orders. Napoleon had wanted the enemy to attack his weak right, and they did. Thanks to the forced march, he now had enough troops to defend it and for his own plan, an attack on the Pratzen Heights.
He knew that the men wanted something more than an ordinary victory. And so his battle plan was to give them an extraordinary victory. He was going to let the enemy throw themselves on him, and in the process of doing that, open up themselves for the riposte, and that counterattack would have the effect of splitting the Allied army in two and utterly destroying it.
Napoleon watched from his command post, waiting to spring his trap at exactly the right time. Still hidden in the fog at the bottom of the valley below the Pratzen Heights were the two divisions, totaling 17,000 men. When asked how long it would take for his hidden soldiers to attack and take the all-important center, Marshal Soult replied, "Less than 20 minutes, sire." Napoleon gave the order to advance. One sharp blow, and the war is over. Now, here's Napoleon's tips for conquerors. Mask your intentions. Keep your enemy guessing. Conduct spoiling attacks to keep your enemy from massing in the defense. Remember, an army marches on its stomach, so be sure you can keep their bellies full on campaign.
On the first anniversary of his coronation, Napoleon launched the most daring plan ever to attack two of the oldest empires in Europe and teach them a serious lesson in modern warfare. Up until this point, Napoleon's battle at Austerlitz had been a masterpiece of deception. Now, he ordered his troops to advance straight through the morning fog and straight at the emperors of Austria and Russia.
He waited until exactly the proper moment to launch a violent counterattack in the center of the Allied army. It was a brilliant plan, magnificently executed.
They began to sweep across the valley and go up to the Pratzen Heights. Just about that time, the famous Sun of Austerlitz begins to burn the mist away, and the Allies look down in amazement to see a rather sizable French force storming up at them.
Beginning on this day, Napoleon associated this blood-red sun with his success and the glories of his great army. This glowing Sun of Austerlitz would warm Napoleon with its favor for the next 10 years. Meanwhile, Tsar Alexander, General Kutuzov, and Emperor Francis watched with horror as French divisions continued to materialize like ghosts out of the fog. Napoleon declared, "They look upon themselves as half defeated. They expect to vanquish me. Let us put an end to this campaign with a crash of thunder that will stun the enemy." At 09:30, the French marched up the hill through musket balls and artillery shells. 100 yards from the Allies, they opened fire, demolishing the center of the Allied position. By 10:00, the French had reoccupied all of the Allied strong points. The final hope of victory for the Third Coalition would be to send in their elite squadron, the Russian Imperial Guard. At 13:00, 3,000 Russian infantry veterans made a magnificent charge. They broke through the French front line with a vicious bayonet attack.
The typical bayonet of the Napoleonic era was a triangular sectioned piece of steel about 15 inches long. It was fitted to the end of the bayonet via a right-angled slot with a locking ring. Now, while the bayonet charge was a proud tradition, it took an extremely well-disciplined and highly trained soldier to make a run at a line of muskets armed only with a bayonet. In fact, the bayonet charge was most effective when it was used against an enemy that was already beaten, an enemy that would just turn and run. Of course, when two soldiers actually did meet at bayonet point on the battlefield, all of that textbook move and fancy footwork went right out the window. It was stab, slash, jab, smash, gouge, rip, anything that'd keep you alive for the next 30 seconds.
A charge by Russian cavalry exploited this breakthrough as the French retreated off the Pratzen Heights. Napoleon immediately called in an extra division, the Mameluk cavalry.
The Mamelukes were almost a living souvenir of Napoleon's famous expedition to Egypt. And they were most noted for their famed weapon, which was a curved sword known as the scimitar.
They were the most vicious and effective fighters on horseback that one could possibly imagine. In the course of their action, they utterly demolished one squadron of the Tsar's finest horsemen. There's even one story about a trooper named Mustafa that cut off the head of a standard bearer of the 3rd Squadron of the Chevalier Guards, took the color, and for that was given the Legion d'Honneur.
For 15 minutes, smoke shrouded the fighting from the straining eyes of all three emperors. When the smoke finally cleared, the French grenadiers and the Mamelukes had slaughtered the Russians. Napoleon was brought back a standard and 1,000 prisoners, including a prince. The Allied center was officially destroyed. Now, Marshal Soult's soldiers faced south in an attempt to turn the Allied left flank.
Suddenly, they find themselves with the French in the center on the Protzen Heights. The right flank of Napoleon is over here, and the Austrians are caught in the middle. It's a hammer against an anvil, and the Austrian army is absolutely decimated.
As the French got closer, hand-to-hand combat began once more. Bayonets stabbed and gouged, fists flew, much to the outrage of the French. They just stopped taking prisoners and started slaughtering entire units of Russians, stripping them of their clothes and boots. The French pushed forward, blocking the main avenue of retreat for the weary Allies. The fastest way out of danger would be across the frozen Sachsen Lake. Napoleon watched from the little chapel of St. Antonin as the chaos began.
The Russian and Austrian retreat over the frozen lake is another one of those sort of propaganda myth moments of the battle. When you read many of the French accounts, well, you have 5,000, 6,000, 7,000 guys falling through the ice in this dramatic moment.
One particular source, I believe he's Austrian, says that soon after the battle, those ponds were drained and there was only two bodies found. So here on the one hand, you have this legend of the ponds where these thousands of fleeing soldiers are finding their icy death. And on the other extreme, there's only two bodies to be found. Certainly the truth lies somewhere in between.
By 1700, the Battle of Austerlitz was over. 15,000 Allies fell victim and 12,000 were taken prisoner. Only 1,300 Frenchmen lost their lives. Tsar Alexander had pressed to fight this battle. Had he followed Kutuzov's advice, the fate of the Third Coalition and Napoleon might have been very different.
The sheer disparity in casualties is certainly a strong argument for how brilliant Napoleon's plan was. But also, one of the most important things is the number of flags that were captured from the enemy and the number of cannons. Remember that these were aristocratic armies. Honor was everything. And for an infantry regiment or a cavalry regiment, their flag, their standard, was an enormous symbol. It was an absolute disgrace to lose it. Napoleon, the first thing he wanted to know after battle wasn't how many did we kill, but how many flags have we got? How many cannons have we captured? That's how he knew how badly beaten the enemy was.
At Austerlitz, Napoleon captured 183 artillery pieces and 45 standards. That evening, an exhausted Napoleon retired to the old post office and awaited the Allied surrender. Meanwhile, in the cellars, his soldiers broke out the caskets and celebrated their victory ankle-deep in wine. On 4 December 1805, Emperor Francis came to sue for peace. A battle was fought today, Francis wrote his wife, which did not turn out very well. An armistice was signed at Chateau Austerlitz, once the base for the Allied emperors before the battle.
Austria was humiliated by their defeat. They were forced to give up virtually all of the territory that they controlled in northern Italy and all of the territory that they controlled in southern Germany. And indeed, the old Holy Roman Empire, as it was known, was pretty much over as a result of the Battle of Austerlitz. The Russians didn't really have to give up anything, but they did suffer the humiliation of being forced to withdraw.
Today, the battlefield is located in the Czech Republic, and it's known as Slavkov u Brna. On the Protzen Heights stands a 70-foot steeple marking the spot where thousands bravely lost their lives.
What caused the French to win the battle was Napoleon. There's an old saying that no plan survives contact with the enemy, and this is exactly the opposite of that. Not only did Napoleon's plan work for him, his plan for the coalition worked right into his hands.
Napoleon fought and won more battles under varying climatic conditions than any other commander in history. From the snows of Central Europe to the sands of Egypt, there were a lot of battles that were politically more important than Austerlitz, but it certainly can be argued that none militarily were greater.
Napoleon had conquered Austria and regained Italy. His battle plan at Austerlitz had elevated his legend to new heights. He was never more admired or feared. Napoleon had seemingly risked everything and yet won his greatest victory. It would be the defining moment in an otherwise unequaled military career. I'm Captain Dale Dye. Thanks for watching Conquerors.